Blessings, my brothers and my sisters. Today we're going to be studying the Great Controversy on Earth. Last week we reviewed the Great Controversy in Heaven, and we studied a little bit about God and about His principles of righteousness, wisdom, and power. And today we're going to take a look at, and we also reviewed how Lucifer got into this thing called sin. And today we're gonna recapitulate what we went over last week. We're gonna do a brief recap, and we're gonna take a look at how those same principles occurred here on Earth, thus having the Great Controversy spread not just from heaven, but even here on Earth. So before we get into that, we're gonna read from the book Education, page 190, as is our custom, just again to lay the foundation and to have us on a point where we may remember and take and get an understanding and a grasp of where we are coming from with this series of studies. So without further ado, we'll take a look at the book Education, page 190, paragraph 2. And it says, "The Bible is its own expositor. Scripture is to be compared with Scripture. The student should learn to view the word as a whole and to see the relation of its parts. He should gain a knowledge of its grand central theme, of God's original purpose for the world, of the rise of the great controversy, and of the work of redemption. He should understand the nature of the two principles that are contending for supremacy and should learn to trace their working through the records of history and prophecy to the great consummation. He should see how this controversy enters into every phase of human experience, how in every act of life, he himself reveals the one or the other of the two antagonistic motives, and how whether he will or not, he is even now deciding upon which side of the controversy he will be found." So we've studied the grand central theme. We've studied the great controversy in heaven, and now we will continue to, as is recommended, study the great controversy here on earth. And even now we're deciding upon which side we are standing on, as I've said before. And I believe that we, at this point in studying God's word, we are standing on God's side. So let's begin with a word of prayer, because surely the enemy does not want us to get the gems that God has prepared and in store for us today. So let's begin with a word of prayer. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for Jesus Christ. We want to thank you for the victory that we have in him. We thank you that though we have fallen and sinned, though your character has been misrepresented, Jesus is still here to give to all of us a perfect representation and reflection of your character, so that by beholding him, we may become changed, so that we may detest sin and go away from it. Father, we ask you that you may open our minds if we have done wrong, or knowingly or unknowingly. We ask that you may cleanse us of all those things so that we may not be clouded in our minds or anything. We may be able to focus here and understand these truths and grab these principles so that they may be our way of life. Lord, that nothing may be between our soul and the Savior, that we may receive what he has for us today. We ask all these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And amen. So last week we reviewed the fact that God is eternal. He's outside of time, invisible. And that being that he's eternal, his attributes, his characteristics, his character is eternal as well. Now we know that God's character is his law. God's character is his law. The law is the transcript of God's character. It's the exact copy. That's what transcript is. It's an exact copy of God's character. So the law, right, we can call it by another name. We could rightly call it God's principles of eternal life. So God's principle of eternal life is God's character. It's God's ways. It's God's attributes, you see. And in reviewing that, we came to the understanding that his character is how he governs, is how he rules all things. And that is with righteousness, infinite righteousness, that is, eternal righteousness. That's why he's always right. Infinite power, meaning he's able to do everything that he wants to do. And everything that he wants to do is good and it is right and it is lovely, right? And he has infinite wisdom, infinite knowledge, infinite power, and infinite justice as well. He's just in everything that he does. He is always, he's right and just in all that he does. And with this wisdom and all that wrapped up in love, it produces everlasting life to anyone who receives it. Anyone who receives the effect of God's perfect righteousness, love, and of course the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, right? Patience, kindness. Anyone who receives that, they receive life eternal. Anyone who accepts it, they're automatically participants of life eternal. Because in receiving it, we automatically give it back. We automatically give it back in receiving it. But when we don't receive it, we naturally do not give it back. And thus that is sin. So God, his attributes bring forth an eternal and absolute rest in every single individual that receives it. So when you receive God's love, which is all that God is love. When we receive that, then the effect is that we love him back. We love because he first loved us. Okay. So God's ways of righteousness leads to a life for you and for me. Let's go to the Bible to make sure that the Bible sustains this fact. Let's go to the book of Proverbs. We're looking in Proverbs chapter 12 and verse 28. Proverbs chapter 12 and verse 28. Now the words will come up on the screen, but it is best that you have your Bible because you want to make sure that what is being said is found in your Bible. Make sure it's found in your Bible. You need to study to show yourself approved, a workman not being ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So we're in the book of Proverbs. So we read, the Bible says, in the way of righteousness is life, and in the pathway thereof, there is no death. So the way of righteousness is life. So righteousness is of God. God is the only source of righteousness. There is no righteousness outside of God, and that way is life. Okay, and in that way there is no death. In that is there any death in God's ways? No, there is no death in God's way because God is righteousness. And we just read, in the way of righteousness is life, and in the pathway thereof, that is the pathway of righteousness, there is no death. Okay. So now let's take a look at the book Mount of Blessings, a wonderful little book that I appreciate so much, an excellent book. I recommend it to everyone to read. Because I've read it and it is excellent. So I want to read to you something that it says about righteousness. And this is where I normally go when I want to read a little bit about righteousness. And it's on page 18, paragraph 1. And here we read what it says. It says this. Righteousness is holiness, likeness to God. And God is love. It is conformity to the law of God. For all thy commandments are righteousness, and love is the fulfilling of the law. Righteousness is love, and love is the light and the life of God. The righteousness of God is embodied in Christ. We receive righteousness by receiving him. So righteousness is love. It is the law of God. The God's law is righteousness. It is love. And the fulfilling of the law, the Bible says, is love. And love cannot be commanded. So God's law, let us not look at God's law as God commanding us what to do. No, God's law is God telling us what he will do in us if we accept his love. God's word works. And so if God tells you his word, the thing is going to happen in you. And his only word for you is words of love. And so, for example, when God said, let there be light, what happened? There was light. And so if God speaks his righteousness to you, then what do you think is going to happen? If you accept the faith of Jesus Christ, if you have faith and you believe in him, then what's going to happen is that righteousness will be the result in your life. You will be a law keeper, not in and of your own strength, but in and of the strength and of the power that is found in the word of God. And the word of God is namely Jesus Christ, who is the righteousness of God. We just read that the righteousness of God is embodied in Jesus Christ. And I remember that we read that Jesus Christ in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 24, it called Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. That is all embodied in Jesus Christ, who is the eternally begotten Son of God. He is the expression of God to all of God's creatures. He's the very expression of God to all of God's creatures. He is the Word of God that has created all of God's creatures. And He is that same Word of God that upholds all of God's creatures. We find in the book of Colossians that it says that in Him, all things consist. You see? So all things consist by Jesus Christ. All things live and have their life and their movement in and by Christ. It is because of Jesus Christ, who is the logic, the wisdom, the genius, the infinite reasoning mental faculties of God. It is because of Him that we live, and it is because of Him that we continue to live. It is all found in Jesus Christ. And I'm going to be referring to my notes from time to time, because there are certain key things that I need you guys to get, that we must get. And we're still laying a foundation. We're still laying a foundation to greater and greater truths. As we continue to study, we're laying foundations to build up what God has to display to us in His Word. So we find that all things consist in Christ. Now, question, is there sin in Christ? No, not at all. You see, Christ is the eternally begotten Son of God. He is God's eternal attributes made visible. He is God's thoughts made audible. He is God's thoughts actually occurring in our field of view. So we can see, so that God's principles of eternity, right? In order for us to see it, and in action, we see Christ. Christ is the expression of God's infinity. I remember we spoke about that last time. Okay, so it is all in Christ. So to choose a way outside of Christ, who is God's wisdom, God's reasoning power, who is God's righteousness, to choose a way outside of Christ, we know that Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. To choose anything, even a little bit outside of that, is sin. It is sin. That is what sin is. Anything outside of God's righteousness, anything outside of Christ, it is sin. So to choose a way outside other than Christ is to deny the way of righteousness that we just read about in Proverbs chapter 12. To choose a way other than Christ, who is righteousness, is to choose a way other than Christ. And what that is, and what that means is that what you're actually doing is that you are embracing death. Let's go to the book of Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 25. In Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 25, the Bible says that there is a way that seems right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. So you see, there is a way that seems right to you and me, but the end of it is death. If the way is anything outside of Christ, then it leads to death. But if it is in Christ, then it leads to life everlasting. In Proverbs chapter 8, we read something else. In verse 35 and verse 36, the Bible says, Proverbs chapter 8, verse 35 and verse 36, write it down quickly and then turn your Bibles. Proverbs chapter 8 and verse 35, the Bible says, "For whoso findeth me," speaking about Jesus Christ, "findeth a life and shall obtain favor of the Lord. But he that sins against me wrongs his own soul, and they that hate me love death." If we hate Christ, we love death. If we hate God's way, we love death. Now, some of us may not outright say, "I hate God's ways, I hate Christ." No, not at all. But whenever we choose a way outside of Christ, whenever we choose a way outside of God's wisdom, whenever we use our power, which we have the right to use, but whenever we use our power, our thinking power, our speaking power, our power of influence, any power that, whatever power God has given us, whenever we use our power without the wisdom of God, without the righteousness of God, without the faith of Jesus Christ, then that is sin. Then that is sin. The Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 14 and verse 23, anything outside of faith, any righteousness outside of faith, any wisdom outside of faith, is sin. And so we need to be sure that everything that we do is according to the wisdom of God, because it is only the wisdom of God that will lead to life eternal. Anything outside of the wisdom of God will lead to death. So it's a matter of life or death. God's way will lead to life. Any other way than God's way will lead to death. And so we need to choose God's way. We should want to choose God's way, because that's not the best way. It's the only way of life, because life is of God. It is of Him and not of us. So we need to understand that sin is an intruder. It is something that cannot last forever. Sin has intruded itself in time, and it self-destructs. It cannot last because it is a way against life. It is a principle that is against life. Okay. Now the Bible says in 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4, the Bible says, "Whosoever committeth sin transgresses also the law. For sin is the transgression of the law." What is sin? The transgression of the law. Now we established that the law of God is God's eternal principles of everlasting life. So sin is warring against God's principles of eternal life. It is warring against God's wisdom, God's way, God's logic in how to live. And when we war against God's logic of how to live, that means that we are choosing to not live. That's actually what it actually really is, plain and simply. And that is what Lucifer did. And we went over that last week. That is exactly what Lucifer did. Lucifer decided to go against God's way. Let's turn our Bibles to the book of Revelation. Let's go to the book of Revelation chapter 12, and let's take a look at it for ourselves. I'm taking out my Bible, and we're going to the Revelation. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 7. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 7. The Bible says, Revelation chapter 12 and verse 7, "And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels." There was war in heaven. But what we need to understand is this, that much happened before there was war in heaven. There was a process before there was war in heaven. There was a discordant note that crescendoed and messed up the celestial harmonies. This reminds me of Psalm chapter 118, verse 14, where the Bible says, "The Lord is my strength and my song, and is become my salvation." But Lucifer wanted to change the track. Lucifer wanted a different song. Lucifer wanted a different Lord, namely himself. He wanted himself to be Lord. And we know this because he began to admire himself, look at his own beauty. You remember in Ezekiel chapter 28? Let's turn our Bibles to Ezekiel chapter 28. In Ezekiel chapter 28 and verse 17, the Bible says, in Ezekiel 28 and verse 17, the Bible says, Ezekiel 28, and verse 17, turning the wrong page. Ezekiel 28 and verse 17, the Bible says, "Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness." His heart was lifted up because of his own beauty. He thought himself to be wise. His own wisdom corrupted himself because he decided to keep his wisdom without Christ. You see what I mean? Now we establish that Jesus is the only way of righteousness and that he is the wisdom of God. So here we see that Lucifer decided to go against the wisdom of God and accept and keep his own wisdom. He decided to go against the wisdom of God, who is Jesus Christ. He was against Christ. You see, he was against Christ, and he had an issue with the Son of God by suggesting a life without him. But God explained to him that there is no life without my wisdom. There is no life without Christ. You cannot live. There is no other way to live other than my wisdom and other than my Son, Jesus Christ. And here is where it gets worse, and here is where we need to pay very close attention. So let's pay very close attention here. There was nothing wrong with Lucifer using his wisdom, but God was there to keep him from falling if he was to use his wisdom without Christ, without God's genius, without God's principles of life. And of course, that is what God did. God was seeking to keep him from falling. God was letting him know, hey, you're going in the wrong direction. And Lucifer listened to him. He heard him, but he didn't do as he said. Lucifer continued in his way. And God continued and persisted. You see, Lucifer persisted in his ways, but God persisted in his ways, which is the way of love, which is the way of unfolding more and more of his love and his patience to Lucifer. Lucifer continued being impatient and continued going against God, and God continued being patient and coming to him and sharing with him the truth about how to live, of the only way to live. But Lucifer continued in his ways. He continued in his ways, and God could not encourage him. God couldn't encourage him, and he warned him that his ways would lead to death. James chapter 1. Let's turn our Bibles to James chapter 1 and verse 15. The Bible says in James chapter 1 and verse 15, "Then when lust hath conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, brings forth death." See, God was doing what he always did. Lucifer was doing something different. And God was letting him know, look, if you continue lusting after your own will and your own way, then it's going to lead to an even worse sin. Well, there's no worse sin, but it's going to continue leading to you in sin. And what that's going to do when it is finished, it's going to bring forth death. You're going to die eternally if you continue going in the way that you are choosing to go. And Lucifer just wouldn't comprehend that. And as God continues to share this with him, Lucifer concludes that, you know what, there is a problem. Lucifer realizes at a point that there is a problem. But the problem is that he concluded that the problem was not with himself, but that the problem was with God. And how often do we do that? Where we conclude that there's an issue, but the problem is not with me. The problem is with brother or sister so-and-so. The problem is with God. The problem's not with me. I'm good. I'm all set. I'm not the issue. Understanding begins with you. Understanding begins with you. What Lucifer needs to understand was that the problem was not with him, with God, that is. The problem was with himself. Understanding begins with you. And Lucifer didn't get that. He threw everything on God. He was wondering, why is God insisting that I don't go my own way? Why is God insisting that I subject myself to his wisdom and to his way of life? Now, first of all, it's good and awesome to subject ourselves to God's way, because God's way is a way of love, of love, joy, and peace and eternity. But Lucifer thought that there could be a way outside of God's way, but there wasn't. So Lucifer's like, why does God continue? Like, I'm trying to go my own way, and he continues to say, no, you shouldn't. I feel like, and this is where Lucifer's mind begins to change. And this is the process of Lucifer becoming Satan. So follow very closely how it happens. Lucifer wants to continue going his way, but God, who is love, continues to share with him, that's not the way, this is the way that you should go, walk ye in it. And Lucifer eventually thinks to himself, well, why is God continually persisting with me? He should have understood that's because God loves him. But he's thinking now, God must be hiding something from me. God must be hiding something from me and all the other angels. God must be lying about something. Why is his son so great? I can be just as good. Why is his wisdom above mine? I'm pretty wise. I'm pretty bright. Why can't Lucifer be exalted even higher? Why not? That's what he began to start thinking. He's thinking now that God is lying. He's thinking now that God is hiding something from him, because God is saying, no, this is the only way. He's thinking that God is hiding something from him and all the angels. And he's thinking that God is a liar. He's thinking that God is a liar. and that God is being selfish. And God is hiding something from him that if he has access to it, if he can use his own wisdom, then he'll be able to get glory for himself. And he's thinking to himself, yeah, God doesn't want me to get glory for myself. And that's why God is not allowing me to go my own way. God wants all the glory for himself. God is selfish. He wants to be exalted himself and nobody else. God is selfish. And that is what Lucifer was saying. Lucifer was saying that God is selfish. And that is how Lucifer became Satan. His mind, because he continued in his way of sin, his mind began to decay, to degenerate, to break down. And he began to see God in a false light. He began to misunderstand God's character of love. He began to misunderstand God's law. He began to see God in a wrong light. And because he saw God in a wrong light, he began to rebel against God. He began to rebel against God because he saw God in a way that God was really not. So what I'm trying to share with you guys is that the seed of the great controversy is the misapprehension, the misunderstanding, the misconception of God's character of love. Wherever the misunderstanding of God's character of love takes root, there is always going to be rebellion against God. Always. And that is exactly what Lucifer did. He began to sow the seeds of doubt upon God's character in the minds of the angels. And some of the angels, unfortunately, accepted his lies. And in accepting his lies, there was war in heaven. He chose his own wisdom, which automatically meant that he rejected God's ways. I want to read something to you because this pertains to us and we need to understand this. That whenever we reject God's ways, we're going to end up just like Satan. In the book Mount of Blessings, page 52, it says something very interesting. Mount of Blessings, page 52, paragraph 1, it says this. Whenever men choose their own way, they place themselves in controversy with God, yea, even a great controversy. They will have no place in the kingdom of heaven, for they are at war with the very principles of heaven. In disregarding the will of God, they are placing themselves on the side of Satan, the enemy of God and man. Not by one word, not by many words, but by every word that God has spoken shall man live. We cannot disregard one word, however trifling it may seem to us, and be safe. There is not a commandment of the law that is not for the good and happiness of man, both in this life and the life to come. In obedience to God, the law, I'll read that again. In obedience to God, the law, to God's law, man is surrounded with a hedge. We're surrounded with a hedge and kept from the evil. He who breaks down the divinely erected barrier at one point has destroyed its power to protect him, for he has opened a way by which the enemy can enter and waste and ruin. So whenever we choose to go our own way, we are choosing to be in controversy, yea, even a great controversy with God. We are not safe to choose our own way. Now, God is not looking to take away our free will. What God is looking to do is, in taking our will, he wants to refine it, perfect it, and give it back to us so that we may cooperate with him, so that we may be partakers of eternal life, just like him, just like him. And so that's why we need to submit and surrender our will to God. Because when we submit our will to God, when our will unites itself with God's will, then we become omnipotent. Then we become, now it is not of ourselves, it is all and wholly of God. Because it is his attribute that is actually being placed and counted and manifest in us. It is all in God. all in Christ and in us when we merge our will with his will. And so that's what we need to do. So Satan went to build up his campaign against God's government by sowing the seeds of the misapprehension of God's character, doubt upon God's character of love to the angels, and he was able to receive, to take one third of the angels with him, one third of the angels to war against Michael and his angels, Michael being Jesus Christ. So let's go to the book of Revelation. Revelation again, Revelation chapter 12. We're back in Revelation chapter 12, and we're going to take a look at verses 7-9. And the Bible says, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place found anymore in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. And he was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So he was cast out where? Into the earth. He did not prevail in heaven. He was cast out from heaven and placed on earth. Okay, placed on earth. So, since sin with Lucifer, since sin, God had one overmastering purpose. God had one overmastering purpose, and that was to get rid of sin. That's all that's on God's mind. It is to get rid of sin. And in order to get rid of sin, well, let's backtrack and take a look at how did sin come about. The seed of sin is the misrepresentation of God's character. Whenever we have a faulty understanding of God's character, whenever we see God in a light that he really is not, then that leads to rebellion. And so if now we have a perfect picture of God, if now we have a proper understanding of God's character, then that will lead to the end of sin. And so what God is looking to do is not to display his character, because he's always done that. So God's not looking to change. God does not change. But what God is looking to do now is to vindicate his character. And this is not for any selfish purpose. This is for the preservation of the universe forever. The only way that we can be preserved for eternity is if we have a proper understanding of God's character of love. So God is not doing this for his own sake, because God's eternal. He's never going to die. He's not even in time. He's outside of time. He created time to spend it with you and with me. Okay, so God is all set. God wants us to be all set. And for us to be all set, we need to have a proper understanding of who he is. And so that is why that is God's number one priority, and that the universe may have a proper understanding of who he is. Because when this is so, when we understand who God truly is, and we understand that God is love, then we will love because he first loved us. Then we will abhor sin, we will hate unrighteousness, and we will love God's way and God's wisdom. So that was God's only purpose. The misunderstanding of God's character is what caused all these issues, and so it is the correct understanding of his character that will fix it. Now, we establish that everything that God is seeking to do is to fix the sin problem. So after Lucifer sinned, God did something quite interesting. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 27. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 27 tells you what God did. The Bible says, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. God created a brand new creature in order to solve the sin problem. God created man to properly represent himself and his character and his way of life to every creature in the universe. God created a brand new creature that knew nothing about the great controversy, that was not there when the great controversy occurred. He created that brand new creature so that the entire universe may now look at them as an example, look at their life as a lesson book, and when the universe looks at them, God created them so that all may see that when you abide according to my will and according to my way, then you will live eternally. It is the only way to live, That's why God created man. And we're going to go through the spirit of prophecy and through the Bible to get a clearer understanding. And we're going to settle this even and make it brighter and brighter and brighter to see why God created man. And I just told you right now, it was to fix the sin problem. To fix the sin problem. And to show the universe the unfolding of God's character of love and selflessness. So let's take a look at the book Education. In the book Education, page 15, it says this. When Adam came from the Creator's hand, he bore in his physical, mental, and spiritual nature a likeness to his maker. God created man in his own image, and it was his purpose that the longer man lived, the more fully he should reveal his image, the more fully reflect the glory of the Creator. All his faculties were capable of development. Their capacity and vigor were continually to increase. Vast was the scope offered for their exercise, glorious the field open to their research. The mysteries of the visible universe, the wondrous works of him which is perfect in knowledge. Now I want to skip down to here. More and more fully would he have fulfilled the object of his creation, more and more fully have reflected the character's glory. So God created man to reflect and to reveal the image of God to the universe so that the universe may now have a clear image of God, a clear image of his character and of how he governs and does things. Because Lucifer painted a terrible image which caused doubt in the minds of the angels and of the unfallen worlds. Lucifer was the number one angel. He was the first of God's angels, the best of all of God's creation. He sealed up the sum, we read in the book of Ezekiel chapter 28. He was the best of all of God's angels. So to see the closest and the best of all of God's angels now have a problem with him, it brings doubt into their heart. It brings confusion into their heart. So God wanted to clear the confusion. He wanted to clear it all. And he created man to clear it all up for the universe. God created man for his glory. Let's go to the Bible to settle this down. Isaiah chapter 43. I recommend that you read all of Isaiah chapter 43, but we're going to highlight a few particular verses in Isaiah chapter 43, and then we're going to dissect it a little bit to get the fullness of the understanding. We're going to be careful Bible students, and we're going to study this Bible line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little. So here we go. We are in the book of Isaiah chapter 43. We're going to read verse 7 to verse 12. Isaiah 43, verse 7 to verse 12. The Bible says, "Everyone that is called by my name," even everyone that is called by my name, God speaking, "for I have created him for my glory. I have formed him, yea, I have made him. Bring forth the blind people that have eyes and the deaf that have ears. Let all the nations be gathered together and let the people be assembled. Who among them can declare this and show us the former things? Let them bring forth their witnesses, that they may be justified. Or let them hear and say, it is truth. Ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant, whom I have chosen, that ye may know and believe me, and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. I am the Lord, and besides me there is no other Savior. I have declared, and I have saved, and I have showed, when there was no strange God among you. Therefore ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, that I am God." So God here is not touting about who he is. God here is educating you and me about his position so that we may know where to go when we are in a time of trouble. God is letting us know what we ought to do whenever things are going bad. We need to look unto him who is our Savior. We need to depend and rely upon him who is our strength and our song and our help in the very time of trouble. We are to look to him whenever we are in temptation. We are to look to him when we need to know the truth as it is in Jesus. We are to go to him when we don't know the way. We are to go to him when we are losing our life. We are to go to him when we want to go in the way of sin, because what he will do is he will do a work in us that we cannot do for ourselves. He will do a work in us that will cause us to want to walk and live according to his ways, his judgments, and his statutes, and to receive his very righteousness. We are to look to him, for besides him, there is no other Savior. We are to go to God. And so here there's some principles that I would like to look at in verse 9. He says, let them bring forth their witnesses. So it's as though God is suggesting, okay, Lucifer can show his witnesses. Lucifer has his own angels. Let him show you his principles and his way of life, and let's see how it ends up for them. Now, we know how it ends up for them because God already told us that the way of sin leads to death. Sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. Now, God created humanity so that all the whole entire universe may see what happens when you live according to God's way. When you allow God to do what he's always done, God is going to unfold his love to the universe in his dealing with man. Caught that? Make sure you catch that. I meant to say, I hope you caught that. That God is going to show the universe how he deals, how he governs. He's going to show the universe how he does that with man. And when the universe sees that, they will see that God is love, selfless, pure, holy, and just in all of his ways. He's going to show the universe. We are the lesson book for the angels and for the unfallen worlds. They are studying humanity. They are studying us. So that's what God is saying in verse 9. And he's also saying that we are his witnesses. We've read that in that last verse, in verse 12, he says, therefore, ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, that I am God. We are God's witnesses, that we are the witness. We are God's witness to the entire universe that he is God. And that reminds me of the first angel's message where the Bible says, where John says in Revelation chapter 14, and I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel. And he said with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. The hour of his judgment is come. The universe is looking at God and is judging God. Now, whether they judge him correctly or incorrectly doesn't matter. It does matter. Hopefully they judge him correctly, because if they judge him incorrectly, then that means that they are wrong and they are bound to death eternally. But the universe is looking upon God right now, and they are seeking to get a proper understanding of who he is, and he is seeking to give a proper understanding of who he is, not for selfish purposes and not by self, but with you and with me. God didn't get into a shouting match with Lucifer. God didn't say, no, I am good. Because Lucifer could just respond and say, no, it's not true, guys. God, it's not true. Listen, he's lying. He's lying to you guys. Then after that, God is going to respond and say, no, it's not true. God, I'm not lying. No, God's not in this business of back and forth. He's not in this business. God demonstrates the truth. God shows the truth. And that is what he is doing with you and with me. And that's what he was doing when he created humanity. He was showing his love and his manifold wisdom as it was working out with us. So, I would like to highlight now something here, because many people, I believe, may get tricked, or not tricked rather, but confused when they read this in verse 7, where it says, I've created man for my glory. Many people read that and think, yeah, God created us so that we could, you know, bow down and worship, and he created us for his glory. It was for him so that he can, you know, whatever. Brothers and sisters, God is not selfish. God is not like us. It says in the book of Psalms, I believe it's Psalm chapter 21, where God says, ye thought that I was altogether like as you are. You thought I was altogether like you. God is not like us. God doesn't think like us. He doesn't act like us. He doesn't do like us. God is not like us. He is diametrically opposed to the way to ourselves. So we need to not think that God is saying, you know, I created you just for my glory. No, brothers and sisters, God is not selfish like that. God is not selfish at all. You see what I mean? God is not selfish at all. So what this means is that we need to understand what is God's glory, because we were created for his glory, and God is not selfish. Therefore, God did not create us for selfish purposes. So what does it mean that we were created for God's glory? We need to understand what is God's glory. So let's turn our Bibles to the book of Exodus chapter 33. But before we go there, let's take a look at Desire of Ages, page 21. In the book Desire of Ages, page 21, it says something interesting there. It's one of Satan's accusations against God. Diary of Ages, page 21, reread the words. It says this: sin originated in self-seeking, selfishness. Lucifer, the covering cherub, desired to be first in heaven. He sought to gain control of heavenly beings, to draw them away from their creator, and to win their homage to himself. Therefore, he misrepresented God, attributing to him the desire for self-exaltation. With his own evil characteristics, he sought to invest the loving creator. And thus, he deceived angels. Thus, he deceived man. He led them to doubt the word of God and to distrust his goodness, because God is a God of justice and terrible majesty. Satan caused them to look upon him as a severe and unforgiving. Thus, he drew men to join in rebellion against God, and the night of woe settled upon the world. So, by the way, when we read that, it says God is a God of terrible majesty. It just means that God is infinitely and absolutely perfect and awesome in all of his ways. He's not terrible as in he's bad. You see, that word terrible, when you study a little bit of Babylonian writings, they used to call their kings and gods, whatever, terrible and awesome. The same way that we say that, well, we shouldn't say this in this way, but if we are juvenile in our ways, we may say, oh, he's dumb smart, or yo, he's mad cool. That doesn't really make sense, but it's just for us to express that he is very smart or he is very cool. So they say he's terrible in his majesty, as just to say that he is extremely awesome in his majesty and in his ways. Okay. So Lucifer misrepresented God by attributing to him the desire for self-exaltation. But God is not in this business of wanting to exalt himself. God is already exalted, and so he's not trying to exalt himself. This is just his condition. So he doesn't need to fight for it. God is not in the business of fighting, because he is. And so he doesn't need to defend himself. He just needs to reveal the truth, which is what he always does. God is not in the business of defending himself or fighting for his own position. God already has his position, so he's not fighting for it. He already has it. Nobody can take it away from him. He's God. You can't take it away from him. So his concern is not for his own position. His concern is for your position. He wants our position to be safe and to be eternal, everlasting. So now we need to understand God's glory. What is God's glory? Let's go to the book of Exodus. We're in Exodus. I mentioned Exodus 33 and verse 18. Moses is speaking to God here. And Moses says, and he said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim my name, the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy to whom I will show mercy. So here we just saw that God's glory is his name. He said, show me thy glory, and God said, I will proclaim my name. So God's glory is God's name, okay? God's glory is his name. So now let's just flip to the next chapter, which is where we will see God proclaiming his name. In other words, God showing his glory. So, Exodus chapter 34 and verse 5. The Bible says, and the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him and proclaimed his name, the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children, upon the third and the fourth generation. So God's glory here we see is basically God's character. His character, abundant in love, in mercy, grace, long-suffering, abundant in goodness and in truth. Now, we just read that he does that this by no means clears the guilty. What that means is that God will not call that which is sinful righteous. He will never call sin righteous. That is what that means. He will never call sin righteous, because God is just in all of his ways. It is unjust to call sin righteousness, because sin is not righteousness, okay? So God's glory, or God's name, is God's character. character of self-sacrificing, selfless, abundantly merciful, and just and perfect love. That is God's character. That is God's character. It is his love which unites his mercy, justice, wisdom, righteousness, and power together in a perfect blend. It unites it in a perfect blend and produces peace. That is God's character, a peace that passes all understanding. And we were created for his glory. That is to say, we were created to express God's love and peace to the entire universe, God's way of life. And we were to show them that his way is right. And do you realize that in us living this life, we are judging Lucifer and God? In the way that we live, we are judging Lucifer and God. If we are living right, then what we are showing is that God's power is able to work in us. But if we are living wrong, then we are saying that God's power can't help us. But that is wrong. God's power can help us. And so if we are living wrong, right, if we are living wrong, then we are declaring, we are saying that God's power doesn't work. We are lying about God. We are misrepresenting his character. You see what I'm saying? We are misrepresenting his character. So we are judging God the same way that Lucifer judged him in saying that God, there's other ways than God's way. But if we live righteously, then we are judging God properly in saying that God is right in all of his ways. But we're also judging the angels, namely Lucifer and his angels. We're judging them if we're living righteously. We're showing that their way is wrong and God's way is right. Let's go to the book of Ezekiel. Let's go back to Ezekiel chapter 28 and verse 17, and there we will see even God said that this is how it's going to be. Ezekiel chapter 28 and verse 17, the Bible says, "Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty, and thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings that they may behold thee." I will lay thee before kings. These kings are you and are me. We are a royal priesthood, a chosen nation, a chosen generation. We are the royalty that God is speaking about here. And that word king is speaking namely about the fact, the context of that word is judges. And so we are going to judge Lucifer, and daily we are judging him, not Lucifer, but Satan. He's Satan now. We are judging him in the way that we live. If we're living unrighteously, we are judging and saying Lucifer is right. This is the only way to live. If we are living righteously, then we're judging him and saying, Lucifer is wrong. The right way to live is God's way. You understand that? If we live unrighteously, then we are saying, Lucifer is right. God's way is not the only way. There is another way. And you know what? God's way is not really possible for us to live. Okay? But if we're living righteously, then we are saying, Lucifer is wrong in all of his ways. All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 3 says, "Know ye not that ye shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life?" So understand that we are going to judge angels, and that God created us for that purpose, to reflect his character to the entire universe. And in doing that, we are judging the fallen angels. God created us for his glory to reveal his character. But now we all know that there was an issue that occurred with man. And I want you to pay really close attention. There's an issue that occurred in man, and that is found in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 9. In Revelation chapter 12 and verse 9, the Bible says, "And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him." So he was cast out to the earth. And on earth, that is where he met man, and that is where he sought to trick man to sin. And you'll find that the same exact way that he went about to trick the angels is the same way that he used to trick man. As a matter of fact, we read last time in The Great Controversy, page 500, we read, it said, in paragraph 2, "By the same misrepresentation of the character of God as he had practiced in heaven, causing him to be regarded as severe and tyrannical. Satan induced man to sin. And having succeeded thus far, he declared that God's unjust restrictions had led to man's fall, as they had led to his own rebellion. So now what we're going to do is we're going to analyze a little bit of how Lucifer caused man to sin. How sinless, perfect man became sinful, imperfect man. And we're going to see that that same process is the same exact thing that happened to Lucifer. So let's turn our Bibles to the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 3. In Genesis chapter 3, we're going to read from starting from verse 1. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 1, the Bible says, "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, has God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day that ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat." So here we see what the devil did to induce Eve to sin. We're going to look at the process, and I'm going to refer to my notes from here and there, because I want this to be properly said step by step. I want you to see step by step how this occurred. First, he questioned her in a way that suggested that God was selfish. Look at the way that he asks the question. And also look at the way that he misquotes. Look at the way that he phrases what he claims that God said. He said, "Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree in the garden?" First and foremost, God did not say, "Ye shall not eat of every tree in the garden." God said, "Ye shall eat of every tree in the garden. But the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, ye shall not eat. If you do eat it, then you will surely die." So God, so Satan, he put the question in such a way that made God seem as though he's a restrictive person. Did God say you shouldn't eat of every tree in the garden? That's not how God said it. God said you can eat of every tree in the garden, but that tree, you should not eat of it, or else you will surely die. Okay? So you see the way that he questioned that. Now, there's a way that we can ask people questions that will suggest, that will mar other people's character. You know how you can ask somebody a question. You'll say, "Did you hear what sister so-and-so did? Did you see what happened to her? Did you hear what happened to her? That makes it seem as though something bad happened to sister so-and-so. That makes it seem as though sister so-and-so did something wrong, you know?" Or you can ask a question like, did the professor say that you shouldn't use a calculator on this test? Like, I'm asking the question in a way that that makes it seem as though the teacher's suggestion makes no sense. And the test is so difficult that you have to use a calculator. It makes no sense for a teacher to say you shouldn't use a calculator. So you see, there's a way to ask questions to make the person that you're asking the question about look bad. So he asked the question about God in a way that suggested that God was being selfish, hiding something from them. He asked it in such a provocative way. He was trying to provoke her into conversation. Never converse with the devil. Never converse with any way outside of God's way. Never allow it to be suggested in your mind. Whenever it comes up, say, "I don't want anything to do with that. Give me Jesus." And so that's what he did. He made what God said seem as though it made no sense. He was looking to provoke a conversation, and that's what he wanted, and that is unfortunately what he got. And then she went on to say, her answer. Now, Satan is very, very attentive. Satan is very attentive. He is a listener. He will sit back, relax, and listen. He will observe. He's a very keen observer. You see, when the sanctuary was being told to Moses and shared with Moses, he was like a fiend trying to understand, what is the sanctuary thing? It seemed as though this is God's mode of communicating with them and sharing with them the plan of salvation. And he studied it. He studied the sanctuary. So he wanted to get in a conversation with her, and Eve went forth, unfortunately, to converse with Lucifer. To Satan. Not Lucifer, Satan. Because now he's the adversary. She went on to converse with Satan. And Satan noticed that there was doubt in her heart. You know how? I'll show you right now. Look at the way she responds in verse 4 and 5. No, rather, and verse 3. Actually, I'm sorry, 2. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of every fruit of the trees in the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. Now, how did Satan know that she had doubt in her heart? He knew that she didn't have full faith, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing from the word of God. She misquoted the word of God. She added to God's word. And so in adding to God's word, he thought to himself, ah, she's trying to strengthen God's word. Therefore, she's doubting it a little bit. And because he figured that, he calculated how to ask his next question or how to make his next statement. The serpent, Lucifer, Satan, was in the tree. He was in the tree. So she said that God said, if you touch it, you will die. But God never said that. God simply said, if you eat it, you will surely die. He didn't say, if you touch it, you're going to die. So she added to God's word. So Satan capitalized on that and said, oh, well, here, I'm on the tree and I'm touching it. I'm touching this fruit and I'm not dead. So what are you talking about? And you know what? When we read in the spirit of prophecy, it actually says that he plucked the fruit from the tree and put it in her hands, and she didn't die. And she said, and she realized, oh, I'm touching the fruit, I didn't die. So now what he's doing, he's sowing the seeds of doubt, and he's seeing that those seeds are sprouting, because she touched the fruit and she realized, oh, I didn't die. What she forgot was that God never said that you would die if you touched the fruit. So now she's thinking that this was God's word. God said this, and here I'm not dead. So God must have been wrong. So now she is receiving a false image of who God is. Now she's thinking to herself, God maybe wasn't telling the truth, because here I touched the fruit and I'm still alive. I'm good. A wrong picture of God is being painted in her mind, and she doesn't even know it. She is becoming delusional. So now Satan went straight out, and Satan straight up said, you will not surely die. In other words, God is lying. So that's the first accusation right there. He's accusing God of being a liar. He's telling her, God is lying to you. God is lying to you. You will not surely die. Second accusation, he accuses God of being selfish. He says that God knows that if you eat this, that you'll become wise like him. You will ascend to, your eyes will be open. You will become greater than what you are right now. You'll become greater. Animals never spoke. Here he is speaking. He's like, hey, I ate this fruit, and here I'm talking. Imagine what kind of powers you will get if you eat it for this fruit. And so he's saying something that's not true. And she's believing it and receiving it. And we know that she's receiving it, because the Bible goes on to say that she saw that the tree was good for food. She saw something that was not true. The fruit was edible, yes, but God said, don't eat it. So she saw something that was not true. Just like Lucifer saw something that was not true. He saw a false picture of God, something that was not true. Same process with Eve. She saw a false picture of God, which was not true. She saw sin, which was eating of the fruit. She saw that it was okay, and that was not true. It was not okay. So she's receiving a false understanding of the principles of righteousness and of wisdom and of God. And so she went against God, unfortunately. Satan painted an ugly and false picture of God in Eve's mind. So a faulty picture of God will always lead to sin. It will always lead to sin, whether we know it or not. You see, at first we were God-centered. And now we have become self-centered. She thought to herself, I'm going to become wise. This is a fruit that's going to make me wise and greater. She wanted a position that God did not wire her for. God created her for a reason in particular. But now she wanted a position that was not hers. And she thought that she can get it by going outside of God's will and God's way and God's righteousness. Unfortunately. But there was also something that was implied. But before I say that, I want to also mention that the sin of disbelieving the true character of God leads to sins. Many may ask, you know, did Eve sin when she ate the apple or before she ate the apple? Folks, she sinned before she ate the apple. Her sin was disbelieving God's character of love, disbelieving God's word, disbelieving God and believing Satan. God showed her that he was love. God showed his love to her and his character. And now another one comes and says lies, and then she disbelieved what God had said. So disbelieving what God says is sin. And that sin of unbelief leads to sins of rebellion, disobedience, going against God's law. Remember in 1 John chapter 1 and chapter 3 and verse 4? Now, there's a whole study on this, but I just want to mention this little point so that we can understand what I just said right now. It says that the transgression, let me turn there right now to say it exactly as it is said there. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4. The Bible says, "Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law." Now, the word that we often miss is that word also. We may not miss it when we read it, but we miss it in understanding it. Let's reread it. Whosoever commits sin transgresses also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. So that word also means that there is something that occurs before law transgression. There is something that occurs before law transgression. If I say that I'm going to go to church today, but I'm going to pick up somebody else, I may say, I'm going to go to church and also pick up brother so-and-so. That means that on my way to church, I'm also going to pick up brother so-and-so. Meaning on my way to church, I'm going to pick up brother so-and-so and go to church. So, or we could look at it in dominoes. Before one domino falls, like if you have like a row of dominoes, right? If you have a row of dominoes, you have one domino, you push that first domino, and then all the other dominoes will fall down, right? Now, before all those other dominoes falls, the first domino must be pushed over. In this scenario, the first domino is unbelief of what God has revealed. When we disbelieve what God has revealed to us about his character, that leads to a domino effect of rebellion, of sins in our life. Whosoever transgresses the law, whosoever sinneth transgresses the law also. Because sin is a transgression of the law. So there is something that is done before law transgression, and that something is unbelief. Disbelieving God's character of love. Disbelieving what God has revealed to us about himself. Okay. So that's what happened to Eve. She disbelieved. She disbelieved. Now back to what I was saying, the other thing, that other accusation that Satan implied. He implied. Now God said, if you eat this fruit, then you will surely die. Lucifer implied in all of his statements, he implied that, look, you're not going to die. You're going to live and you're going to become better. But if you do die, now this is implied in his statement, if you do die, it is because God killed you. You see that? I'm going to break it down. If you do die, it is because God killed you. Because God does not want you to become better than him. God does not want you to choose your own ways outside of his way. God does not want you to do that because he knows that if you do that, that you'll become greater than him. That you will receive glory that he only wants for himself because he's selfish and a dictator and he wants everything for himself. God knows that if you choose your own ways, you're going to become better than him and just as great as he is. But he doesn't want you to do that. So if you do eat of that fruit, then it will happen to you. And you will not die. But if you do die, it is because he was angry and he went forth to kill you because he does not want you to become greater than he is. That is what the devil is implying. And that is a lie from the pits of hell. God did not say that if you eat of the fruit that he's going to kill them. He didn't say, if you eat of the fruit, I will kill you. No, he said, if you eat of the fruit, you will surely die. So Satan, what he was trying to do, he was sowing seeds of doubt for the future. What that means is this. He was saying, you will not surely die. God is lying. But if you do die, then it's because God killed you. What you need to understand is that after you eat this, you will become great. But now you're going to have to run away from God because he's going to be out to get you. You may be afraid, and naturally you're probably going to be afraid because God is kind of big and strong and whatnot, and he's going to want to destroy you. So you're going to have to run away, go away from God, go as far away from God, because now he's going to want to kill you. That is what Lucifer planted in their minds. That's what he planted in their minds. What they should have understood was that God is love and everything that he does is for love and by love and for the preservation of love and eternal life in his creatures. But they misunderstood that. Satan was instilling in them fear, not respect, but fear, being afraid of God as opposed to being afraid of sin. He was putting in their minds that God is going to kill them if they eat that fruit, which is not true. What they need to understand is that sin kills. What they need to be afraid of and run away from is sin, not God, but from sin. Because sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. Sin brings death, not God. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death. The wages of sin is death, okay? That's the wages of sin. That's the result of sin, death. But the gift of God is what? Eternal life. So if you sin, then God is not coming to you with the death decree. God is coming to you with the life decree to give you life, eternal life as a free gift in Christ. So Satan was putting fear in their minds of God. And God wants to put fear in our minds, not of him, but of sin, so that we may hate sin and love righteousness, hate evil and love good, which is all in him. Oh, brothers and sisters, let us get this today, that God is a love and in him there is no hatred at all. He is out to save, not to condemn. Why is God going to waste his time trying to condemn you and me when we already condemned ourselves? We sinned. We already condemned. We already condemned ourselves. What sense does it make for him to condemn us when we are already condemned? We are already condemned because we sinned. So God didn't come to condemn us because we are already condemned. God is not, God came to save and to restore us. He came to save and to restore us. Sin is what destroys. God is the restorer. Satan is the destroyer. So we need to have the proper picture of God in our mind. But why did God have to put the tree there, we may ask? For two reasons I'll mention out of many. The first reason that God put the tree there was to teach them respect. It was to teach them respect, to respect other people's property. Because the world was going to become populated now with tons of human beings. And so because the world was going to be populated, God was trying to teach them to respect one another's property. It was to teach respect, okay? The second reason was to protect us. He put that tree there to protect man. Because the only place that Satan could tempt man was there at the tree. And so long as we stayed away from the tree, that would be us staying away from Satan and staying close to God. And that is the only place where there is maximum security and safety. Away from him and close under the wings of God. So he put the tree there to protect us. Because he had to allow Lucifer, Satan, to test his ways and to test his things and to test his principles. And so for God to completely bar him would be unfair. So God placed the tree there, and that's the only place where Satan can do any of his works. It's the only place. And he put it there so that we may exercise our free will. We are free to choose to go by the tree or to stay away from it. If we choose to stay away from it, we're choosing to stay with God. If we choose to go with it, we're choosing to go in the way of temptation, which leads to death. Which leads to lust and then sin, and then sin leads to death, you see. But we can overcome temptation. Our first parents should have gone there. And you know what? Let's not speak about them as though we wouldn't have done it. We would have done the same, unfortunately. So it was there to protect them from Satan. So man was created in God's glory, but now man sinned. They marred the image of God in themselves. But now question, does God change? God never changes. Does God's purpose change? God's purposes never change. Therefore, though man sinned, God's purpose for man has still not changed. His purpose for us is still to reveal and unfold his glory to the entire universe. We'll notice that one of the most glorious mysteries about God is that opposition enhances the ultimate victory of his work. What we need to do is look to Jesus, and by beholding him, we will become changed into his perfect image. There is nothing that you can do against the truth, but for the truth. So if God be for us, then who can be against us? Sin cannot overcome God. Yes, man has sinned. Yes, now man has a sinful human nature, and we are bent towards evil. We are bent towards doing that which is wrong. But God will still use us, despite our bad equipment, to reflect and to reveal his glory to the entire universe. And they will see that even if man has bad equipment, God can still work through them and with them and overcome sin and show his glory to the entire universe. In Education, page 18, paragraph 1, it says, as the perfection of his character is dwelt upon, the mind is renewed and the soul is recreated in the image of God. I am thankful that we have Jesus Christ to look to, and we're going to study more about him in our next study, about how Jesus, our Redeemer, is now the one whom we look to, and by receiving him, we receive the righteousness of God, thus enabling us to reflect and reveal his glory to the entire world. In First Bible Commentary, page 1085, it says this, in the section entitled Instantaneous Substitution. It says, the instant man accepted the temptations of Satan and did the very thing God had said he should not do, Christ, the Son of God, stood between the living and the dead, saying, let the punishment fall on me. I will stand in man's place. He shall have another chance. He shall have another chance. Jesus came and stepped in the gap. We were supposed to die immediately, but Christ stood between the living and the dead, and he said, if man will live again, I will give him another chance to live. I will give him he will still fulfill my purpose for him. This is a wonderful story of the grand central theme of the entire Bible, which is the plan of redemption. So the great controversy is actually that the main theme is actually, I don't want to call it the main theme because the grand central theme is the theme of redemption. But the great controversy is the theme in which everything is being played out. It's the thing in which everything is being played out. And the main theme is what Christ has done. What Christ has done. The devil did much work in misrepresenting God's character in heaven to all the angels and on earth. And so God is in a place right now where he needs to perfectly reveal his character to the inhabitants of heaven and the unfallen world and to the inhabitants of earth. And in doing all that, he also has to save man, because that is remaining consistent with his character of love. So he has to give a perfect reflection of his character to the world and to the whole entire universe, and save man at the same time. And he does all of this in Christ. It is all done in Christ and by Christ. By Christ. So this is why the Son of God came to earth. Let's go to John chapter 1, 1 John chapter 3 and verse 8. We're beginning to wind down. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 8. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 3 and verse 8, "He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning." And listen here. "For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil." Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. You see, man was not created to be saved. Okay? Man sinned and thus needed salvation, but he was not created to be saved. Jesus Christ came in order to destroy the work that the devil did with man, so that man can fulfill the purpose that God created him for. So Christ's coming has given man the ability to fulfill the purpose that God has fulfilled for him. Jesus came and gave the perfect reflection of God's character to the universe. Despite the fact that he had the bad equipment that we did, he had the same bad equipment that we did, our human nature, he perfectly represented his Father's character of selfless love. He saved man from ruin and from eternal death. So he saved man from ruin and eternal death, and in doing that, he reflected God's character of selfless love. The Satan said that God was selfish, and God manifested, "I am not selfish. I am selfless, and I'm willing to give up myself to save man." And in showing that to the universe now sees that God really, indeed, is love. He's not hiding anything from us. He has revealed to us in the greatest way his love by being willing to die, to step into death, to save those that were there, to give them righteousness and life eternal. Christ is God's step into time. But further than that, Jesus Christ, who is God, who is Jehovah, is salvation. He came to save us from sin. Sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. So Christ came to save us from death. So that means that Christ is not only God stepped into time, he is God stepped into death to save those that were there, to take them out of there into life more abundant. And I'm glad of this truth, that life is all in Christ. In our next study, we're gonna take a look at and more thoroughly look into how Christ did this. How Christ redeemed man. And in doing this, revealed the highest expression of God's character, which then keeps the whole universe on an eternal basis of security and safety. I'm going to read a few points that I pray that you receive. God can successfully solve any problem and overcome any opposition to his government. Those who go against God are going against eternal love, eternal wisdom, eternal power, and righteousness. In the great controversy, God uses self-sacrificing love to overcome the enemy, and the greater the opposition, the greater the unfolding of his love. Lastly, the challenge of the sin problem has been turned by God into an overwhelming victory for his government. And I'm thankful that God has chosen you and me. Though we are sinful and weak and pathetic in all of our ways, he has chosen us to be filled with his Spirit so that we may reveal and reflect his character to the entire universe and prove to the world that he is Lord God, love and righteousness and perfect goodness. So brothers and sisters, let us be filled with the Spirit of God so that we may fulfill the eternal purpose of God. Yes, there's a great controversy here on earth, but that great controversy will, as a matter of fact, it has been crushed in Jesus Christ and by Christ. So let Christ dwell in you. Receive the infilling of Christ so that it may work out in your life, so that you may judge the world and show them all that God indeed is just and righteous in all of his ways, that God's way is the only way to live, and that God is love. Be filled with his Spirit today. Let us close with a word of prayer. Our Father, our God, we thank you for these wonderful truths that you have taught us thus far today. We ask you that as we continue to read, as we continue to review and to study, that we may come to a deeper and a greater understanding of these wonderful, magnificent truths. We ask that Jesus may continue to teach us more and more and more about him. Continue to repeat and reiterate these principles in our minds, that your Holy Spirit may make us new, that our minds may be transformed by your principles of love. Cleanse us of all sin, Father, so that we may receive more and more and more of you, Lord. That we may understand these principles and choose your principle of life, your way of life as well, so that we may justly and properly judge the entire universe and prove to the world that you are loved. Lord, that we may fulfill your purpose, which is to reveal your glory to the entire world. We ask all these things in the precious and most holy name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. God bless.